Houston Station, we're ready for the event.
ACR, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Houston ACR. How do you hear me?
We've got you loud and clear. Looking forward to talking to you guys.
Please stand by for opening remarks.
Hello, space enthusiasts. My name is Ms. Pack, the Director of Software Engineering Academy and Computer Science Teacher at Richmond Hill High School, located in Queens, New York City. I've been very fortunate enough to be a part of NASA Educator Network by participating in early career research programs, Climate Change Research Initiative, for the past 2 years. We are thrilled to be a part of another amazing NASA event today, where our students will have the opportunity to ask questions to astronauts aboard the International Space Station. Without further ado, here is our first question.
Hi, I'm Manisha, and my question is, what are some hardships growing plants in space?
That's a great question, because our plants get a lot of attention up here when we're successful with them. So to understand why it's hard to grow plants in space, you got to think about what plants need on Earth. So the first thing is sunlight, right? Plants take energy from the sun and they convert it in order to grow. They need air. They need the different nutrients that are in the air, specifically carbon dioxide especially. And they also need certain temperatures, and different plants like different temperatures. So next time you go to the grocery store, maybe look around and see where all the fruits and vegetables are grown, and you're gonna see that they're grown all over the place because different plants like different temperatures. They also need certain soil, so nutrients from the soil, and they need water, right? And the plants on Earth count on water hitting the ground and then going down through the soil and going all the way down to the bottom of their roots, right? It actually gives a cue for the plant on how deep the root should go. So out of all those things I just talked about, how many of those do we have up here in space naturally? None. So here on Space Station, we have to create each one of those things artificially. And it's really challenging because, like I mentioned, different plants like different things. And so it's really difficult to make a lot of different plants successful at the same time. And it can take a lot of energy, but we are doing it. And we're getting better at it every year.
Hi, my name is Dylan. And my question is, how is the food transported to space? And what if something goes wrong with it, since it takes time to transport?
Hey, Dylan, thanks for the question. Yeah, we transport food on multiple different cargo vehicles. So we've got several different types of cargo vehicles that we bring food and science and equipment up on, including some of the crewed vehicles. Our vehicle actually brought some food up with us as well. We've got cargo space on some of the crewed vehicles. If something happens, like we miss a cargo mission, we always have an extra reserve of food on board the station, so we'll just start eating into those reserves as NASA comes up with a game plan for how we're going to get food back up and get our stores back up. So NASA's always got a game plan and a backup plan for things when they fail.
Hi, my name is Tenrin, and today I'm here to ask a question. How is the space station getting power to run the lights on the space station?
Yeah, Tanvin, that's an excellent question, because power generation is so important for every single thing that we do up here and life support. We would not last long if we didn't have power. So the lights are powered actually by solar power. So if you look at a picture of the space station, on each side of the space station, you're going to see these giant gold, what we call solar arrays. Those solar arrays are capturing energy from the sun and transporting them to batteries. At the base of the solar arrays, we have multiple batteries that power is stored into, and then it is brought to the space station for all the different needs of space station. Now, what's interesting about it to me is that we fly at 17,500 miles an hour, which means every 45 minutes we have a sunrise and a sunset, and a sunrise and a sunset. So half the time, there's no sun on those solar arrays. So those batteries actually store the energy during sun, when they're getting charged by the sun, so that when we go into the darkness, we use the energy from the battery. So they're just constantly charged and discharged all day long.
Hi, my name is Emily, and my question is, how does being in space feel for your stomach, and does it feel like being on a roller coaster?
This one's a fun question. So I think initially the first moment we got into space, I did feel a little bit of a jolt as we got into zero G and the engines cut off. But on a day-to-day basis, we're so far up, we experience a little bit of gravity and we're kind of falling around the Earth, but it doesn't feel like falling up here. We're just floating. And so the only time that I've noticed my stomach feels different is actually eating. You get a little bit fuller faster because all those organs are not exactly in the spot that they were on the ground. And then running, I've noticed as well. There's a lot of motion when you're running, you know, you're bobbing up and down, and I've noticed my stomach kind of feels that a little bit. But outside of that, we're just floating right here.
Hi, my name is Seema, and my question is, do you have to do a lot of maintenance on the space station?
Hi, Seema. There is a lot of maintenance on space station. This is a very big space station, and our livable compartment is about 3,500 square feet, so kind of the size of a decent-sized house. And if you think about the house that you live in, so everybody picture where they live. And picture all the different systems that are in your house. Okay, you've got plumbing, right? When you turn on the sink, water comes out, you flush a toilet, you turn on the lights, the electricity comes on. We have all those systems on space station, except for when anything breaks, we can't call a plumber or an electrician. We have to be the plumbers or the electricians. And so we don't want to run all of our systems until they fail. And so we also do a lot of preventative maintenance. So we do a lot of cleaning or changing out items that we think are about to fail. So we do a fair amount of maintenance. It's probably about a quarter of our time.
Hi, my name is Serenity, and my question is, what tasks do you enjoy the most in space?
Ooh, so I'm on about day 10 or 11 in space total, but I've done a little bit of maintenance, a little bit of science. I think actually some of the most fun I've had so far is working with Anne on a couple experiments and data collection. So, for example, today we're going to go measure, basically put an EKG on her eyeballs and look at her eyes and measure some data there. We're going to dilate them and we're going to take really detailed pictures inside of her eyes, and so I get to be the operator that that does all of that. So I'm pretty excited about all of the science that's happening, especially when I get to, you know, poke Anne in the eyeball.
Hi, my name is Jadier, and my question is, how does an astronaut usually prepare to travel to a space station?
Yeah, that's a really great question. There's so many different phases and levels of our preparation. And our preparation really started at your age. Taking all of the classes that we needed to take to get the ability, not just for the information that we needed to know, but also learning how to learn, and the teamwork. We work a lot with one another up on Space Station. This is the ultimate team sport. And so everything that you're doing right now, you can consider astronaut training if that's the route you're headed down. As we get closer to flight, we focus a lot, actually, on what might go wrong on our mission, because if something happens up here on space station, all of us have to know exactly how to respond. And so we do a lot of training on our emergency and contingency procedures, and then we do a lot of training for just how to keep space station healthy and how to live in space. And then as we get really close to flight, and you're kind of within a week or two, you know, there's a lot of mental preparation that goes on to prepare to leave your life for 6 months at a time. And so, you know, you want to make sure all your loved ones know that you love them. You want to get in all the hugs that you can, get in all the chips and salsa that you can, because you're not going to see those for a while. And so there's a lot of mental preparation as well. So it requires some fortitude. So we are constantly preparing, and actually we're still preparing now. So we're still preparing for what we're going to do next week and the week after. It's kind of a big cycle.
Hi, my name is Nan. I would like to ask a question. How do you provide the carbon dioxide necessary for the plants to grow in the space station?
Mm-hmm. You know, there's a naturally occurring carbon dioxide up here, and every time that we exhale, and we do have machines that scrub the CO2 for us, but there's also plenty of carbon dioxide. There's actually a little bit more carbon dioxide on the space station than what we have naturally occurring on Earth. So there's plenty of carbon dioxide up here, even though we scrub it with the machines.
My name is Jasmine, and my question is, how does it feel to see space in such a different light compared to us on Earth? Does it make you question how much we still don't know about space.
Yeah, Jasmine, I really love that question because you're hitting on something that really struck me when I was on my first spacewalk. And I think a lot of astronauts have a similar experience, which is, you know, the space station where we're at right now, it's huge. It's like the size of a football field. And it's 250 miles off of Earth. So if you were to get in your car and drive straight up, you'd be here in about 6 hours, if that drive was possible. Now, relatively speaking, when you think about how big the universe is, that means that we're really, really, really close to Earth. So I remember being on my first spacewalk, and a lot of people say, did I feel far away from Earth? And I was holding onto the side of the space station, I looked down, and actually Earth was the closest thing that I could see. And then I kind of turned around the other direction, and I just looked at the absolute vast depth of outer space, and I was so humbled by how small we were, how fragile our planet is, how we live on the best planet in the solar system, at least from what I've seen, and how much more we have to explore. You know, for us, the moon does not look any closer than it does for you guys when you look out at night. And so the depth of space is something, it's not just Earth or space. Space itself is absolutely enormous. And to me, you're absolutely right, Jasmine, that was a really humbling realization to me on how much more there is to learn.
Hi, my name is Mahindra. My question is, what is your first impression on seeing all the stars and the Earth? Was visiting space part of your bucket list?
Oh man, I think bucket list checked for sure. You know, I've had the dream of being an astronaut since I was a little kid, and you know, finally getting to realize that dream here has been pretty amazing. And I think the view of the stars and the Earth is fantastic. It's hard to put it into words. The first time you see the Earth from space, you get to see just all of the different processes that happen on Earth. You get to see all of the different people, and you know, it's just one giant world out there, and learning the continents by what they look like and not what the map says and what each country looks like and where the lines are. It's pretty fascinating. And you know, looking up at the stars from Earth was awesome. It's one of my hobbies on Earth and as a child growing up, and looking at them from space is even more beautiful. For some reason, everything just seems much more clear and crisp up here, so it's been quite the adventure so far.
Hi, my name is Valentina, and my question is, what's your favorite space-friendly food?
All right, Valentina, I'm really glad that you asked this because I will look for any excuse to have my favorite space snack. So I'm going to ask Vapor here to tend the mic so that you can still hear me. And now all of our food comes up in wrappers like this, and it's actually to protect the food for... They last longer in these wrappers than they do if we just set them up. So we'll get that trash later. And in here, I have some little chocolates. And I'm going to show you why they're some of my favorite. I mean, not only do they taste delicious and they give you a little bit of energy, but they're really good to share with friends. So let's reward Vapor for holding the mic. So, those are my favorite space snacks.
Hi, my name is Daniel, and my question for you guys is, what does a typical day in space feel like?
Chewing my chocolate candy there. a typical day, you know, we work 10 to 12 hours a day, depending on the day. And the ground team does a fantastic job of scheduling all of the different maintenance tasks and science and exercise for us. So we exercise every day to make sure that we minimize the bone and muscle loss that happens when you're not under gravity's pull. And then, you know, if the toilet breaks, someone's got to go fix it. And so they'll figure out who's got the time on their schedule. And then we also do all sorts of science, whether it's on our own bodies or in one of these many racks here. You can see all around us, we've got racks full of science going on. And so every single day we're doing something different, and we're touching one small piece of science that's feels small here, but it's someone's life work on Earth, and it's a really great honor to work on that, and it's a privilege to manage somebody's science experiment to help you know, inform us on the ground, how we could make things better on the ground, but then also how do we get further into space, you know, onto the moon and onto Mars eventually.
Hi, my name is Raquel, and my question for you is, when you're up in the spaceship and you bump into something, does it hurt as much as it does on Earth, and does it happen as commonly as it does on Earth? Thank you.
Raquel, yes, it happens commonly, and we are both laughing because this has happened. So when we got here a week ago, our friend Nick Hague was on board, and he said something that just made us laugh, but it's also proven true over and over again. He said, look around the space station. I want all of you guys to look around to each of these things. We have metal brackets. We have metal ceilings. We have metal floors. We have metal handrails that our feet are on. And Nick said to us, remember, everything here is really hard, but you are still squishy. And that is so true. We are squishy, and things hurt up here. When you stub your toe in the middle of the night, it's just as bad as on Earth.
Hello, my name is Mr. Alamari, principal of Richmond Hill High School, and I want to extend my deepest gratitude to the crew of the International Space Station for taking the time to speak with our students today. A special thank you as well to everyone who made this incredible event possible. Opportunities like this inspire the next generation of innovators, scientists, and engineers, showing them that the sky is not the limit. It's just the beginning.
Station, this is Houston ICR. That concludes the event.
Thank you to all participants. Station, we're now resuming operational audio communications.